Good morning, SCC family.
Good morning.
Welcome everyone to our worship service this morning. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to extend a special welcome to everybody on Facebook Live. Whether you're at home or you're here with us, we're so happy that you're here in service today. Please join me as we lift our voices to share our opening sentences. This is the day that God has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
As we prepare ourselves for worship this morning, I invite you to please check out the Welcome to First Congregational Church page in the back of your bulletin. It has information on our Green Connection card and our COVID protocol, also how the live stream works and how we welcome children in worship. One quick note, the COVID numbers are in the green zone.
Yeah.
So that means face masks are optional, but please do what makes you feel safe. Use social distancing as you are comfortable. And please respect others' social distancing as well. As always, if you have a question, ask an usher. And now, let's have church.
Good morning, SBC family. It is so good to see everyone here this morning. I want to say a special hello to any first-time visitors that are here. Please take a look at the folks that are sharing the pews with you, for the members of this church truly are the ministers of the church. And if you have a question, please reach out to someone nearby, for we are all here to serve one another. Friends, this morning we stand on the cusp of transition. We move from darkness to light in the natural world around us, yet from light to darkness, as we prepare to move from epiphany to light. As we do, we place our trust in God's presence, which is always surrounding us, and we gather in hope that no matter what the journey ahead holds for us, we can face it with courage and faith, knowing that Christ walks with us. For we gather here as seekers, not for answers, but for wisdom, not for doctrine, but for a way of life inspired by the radical love of Jesus the Christ. Let us be together now in the spirit of sacred and holy worship.
The glory of God transfigures the everyday.
Figures familiar faces.
At the height of our worship, may God's presence shine through the commonplace. God's light, shining in the face of Christ, illuminates all our days. Amen. Or a regular FCC pose. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. hear that it's kind of so much in it. Good morning. Thank you for just splashing those bright, those bright and shiny.
Made a new word.
Bright and shiny. I don't need to read today. So today we are on the steps, and we are talking. Yeah, come on up. Come on up. Come all the way up. All the way. Yes, all the way to the mountaintop. You want to drive me all the way? Right here? You know that I refer to our creation room as the mountaintop before, right? Where we go and we, you know, we experience a form of enlightenment, which is what Jesus did when he had this moment, which is known as transfiguration, right? Let's say that beautiful word together. I love it. Transfiguration. And I think of this in many ways. I have many stories to share about what that means to me. But today, I'm going to put it in the context of a couple of weeks ago, Miss Dillis. Do you remember Miss Dillis Burke? Well, for me, she was kind of like playing the role of Christ there. She came up to the mountain. She took us up to the creation room. And she shared some really amazing information that opened our eyes, yeah? She opened our eyes to some things that we maybe kind of knew, but didn't really realize the impact of this information. And I thought maybe you guys could share, Eli and Aaron, I think some of your post-its are here, some of the things that her inspiration, her enlightenment, oh, and here she comes, look at that, on cue. Wonderful. Yes, so she shared with us the information about the plastic in our world and what it was doing to our planet and to us. And so some of the things we learned.
All right, 2.6 trillion pounds of waste is produced per year. 53.6 billion pounds of clothing is produced per year. And the reason why I said clothing is because clothing is sometimes does have plastic in it. Plastic, because of the way it heats up, it could be the part of the eruption of Yellowstone. And plastic is at the deepest point of the Mariana Trench, which is currently the closest point to Earth's core.
Doesn't sound too good, does it?
No.
No.
It takes 1,000 years for one plastic bottle to decompose. That's 33 billion pounds of plastic enters the oceans every year. Over 100,000 animals die from plastic consumption every year. There is a study that was conducted that shows that everybody has microbes of plastic in their muscles and their lungs are basically they have plastic inside of them. So the microplastics humans have in their lifetime eat about 40 pounds of plastic. Final conclusion, plastic equals
plastic is bad, and our minds kind of just exploded with learning. We wanted to learn more and more and more, thanks to Dillis sharing what she knew, sharing her inspiration, her light, and shining a light on something really important. And it opened the light in all of us to share more and not just keep this knowledge to ourselves, which is, to me, what happened on that day that Jesus took his disciples, his students, up to the mountaintop, and basically revealed, I am a ball of light. I am a light being. I am not just this human form, right? And I am powerful. And Dillis also shared with us that we are powerful and that there's something we can do about this, right? And next Sunday, we are going to actually have a ceremony to initiate a transfiguration in our lives so that we can all stop using so much plastic, and pick the water bottle credit. So I'm going to turn the mic over to John as we pray and remember the power of God within us to make this transfiguration happen.
Today we will again give thanks for our identity as God, our home is safe, protection guaranteed in all we do, power and strength available to us with all our undertakings. We can fail in nothing. Everything we touch takes on a shining light that blesses and heals. And one with God and with the universe, we go our way rejoicing with the thought that God has done.
Center ourselves in this time of prayer. Just a friendly reminder to please fill out the green connection cards that are in your bulletin. If you have a prayer that you would like shared in the confidence of the pastoral staff, then please indicate that. If you have a prayer that you would like lifted up in worship, then we are happy to share the prayer next Sunday. And the green connection cards will be collected during the offertory time. Now let us breathe deeply. Center our heart, soul, and mind in the presence of God. Holy One, we pray for Chuck, Mace, and Angela, who is facing a procedure for uncontrollable blood pressure. We also lift up prayers for his brother who is struggling with kidney issues. God, in your mercy. We lift up prayers to Rick's mom, Doreen, who will be entering hospice care. We pray that she is surrounded by love, and we pray for her family through this transition. God, in your mercy. We pray for Christina, who has been diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer that has spread to her lymph nodes. We pray for successful treatment and strength for her loved ones. God, in your mercy. We pray for Lori's mom, who is struggling with nausea, which is affecting her overall health. God, in your mercy. We pray for Deborah and Bill, the family of Milton Ross, who passed away this week. We pray that you surround them with your loving presence. God, in your mercy. We hold in our prayers President Jimmy Carter, who is moving into hospice care. God, in your mercy. And we lift up all your children in Turkey and Syria, whose lives have been lost, whose families have been traumatized, and their communities devastated by the recent earthquake. We pray for continued strength, endurance, and hope for the workers who are continuing to sift through the rubble, for the hospitals and medical care teams who are struggling to give care and aid to the wounded, to the survivors who have lost homes and livelihoods. May your love be shown through all the aid workers from across the world who are arriving each day, to the funds and supplies that have been donated from across the world, and from the prayers of so many who are surrounding them with your love. God, in your mercy. Holy One, wherever two or more are gathered in your name, you are there. And so you are here, healing us, inspiring us, and gently redirecting us so that we may see the world as you do and love it with your love. So in this time of prayer, we offer aloud whatever joys or concerns rest on our hearts this day. God, in your mercy.
Prayers for my daughter's friend, Shai, who passed away yesterday. Prayers for her daughter, Aaliyah, and their whole entire family. And continue prayers for my daughter as she makes a very important decision regarding her heart condition. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
recently had a heart attack and this week has been diagnosed with cancer. Give him courage and strength to continue his journey. God, in your mercy.
Yes. A prayer of gratitude for the many, many, many prayers that came from this congregation that got me back here today. I thank you all. God, in your mercy.
Yes.
Holy One, you are the mother and the father of us all.
And you have heard our prayers, both those that we have lifted up aloud and those that we have kept in the silence of our hearts. Hear us now as we join as one family of faith to share aloud the prayer that Jesus, your Son, and our brother taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
That we can live out our faith here at SPC beyond Sunday morning. Here are several many coming opportunities to connect and serve. So please get your pencils out, your pens, mark up in your bulletin what you're interested in, because there's a lot that's coming at you right now. This morning, because we are in the COVID green zone, we are pleased for the return of coffee. Yay! Many thanks to Dawn and Patty for hosting this morning. Our coffee hour will be held in the sanctuary immediately following worship. Hosting coffee hour is a great way to become involved in our church, and it's easy to do. If you'd like to help us host the coffee hour, please see Deb Duhamel if you get to. And also, if you'd like to help coffee hour by giving a donation, please choose coffee hour as a drop-down on the FCC giving page. We hope that you'll also stay for a presentation on elder law by SCC member Donnie Dennison. That'll be in the sanctuary starting at noon. Elder law seeks to address the complex intersection between estate planning, government benefits planning, and long-term care planning by addressing issues affecting both the old and the young alike. This week, our season of Lent begins. It's a time of honest self-reflection and grappling with our mortality and facing our shadow sides as we prepare for the experience of Holy Week and Easter. We will begin our season with a service on Ash Wednesday at 7:30 in the sanctuary. Through deeply meaningful rituals, tithe music, and Holy Communion, we will begin our six-week wilderness journey together, and all are welcome. We have a design for SCC water bottles. Just like Reverend Karma and the kids were explaining, with our Hit the Bottle campaign, we are transitioning away from single-use plastic water bottles. So we're offering a new SPC water bottle. If you love SPC and you want to help protect Mother Earth, please consider purchasing one. Also, on Saturday, February 25th, we will hold a special Renton Labyrinth Walk with Celtic Park. Labyrinth walking is a wonderful way to deepen your spiritual practice and spend some time listening to your soul. The unstructured walk will be open from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. here in Sanctuary. Also, beginning on Sunday, February 26th and running through the season of Lent, we will be offering a special weekly spiritual practice of mindfulness meditation with the Labyrinth walk. The experience will be led by Sam Rolaski, Reverend Anselm, who is a certified mindfulness meditation teacher. The walk will be each Sunday afternoon from 3 to 4:30 p.m. All are welcome to that. This Thursday,
we will begin our new members' inquiry classes. If you have been worshiping with us and feel we may be your church home, these classes are for you. We'll share our faith stories, learn about the values, the theology, and history of the congregation, and understand what it means to be a member here. The classes will be held on Zoom Thursday, February 23rd, Wednesday, March 1st, and Wednesday, March 8th at 7:30 p.m. If you're interested in joining this, please send an email to Reverend Amy. And now we have a special announcement.
Interested in participating in that. We're doing this follow-up announcement, and we would like for those who weren't there the first time to sign up again today after church in the palace. We'll be there. And also to announce, so we have a start date. Because everybody's been asking, so we said, you know, let's get moving. We are so excited. It's going to be March 3rd at 7:30. In the Creation Room upstairs. So March 3rd, that's a Friday, at 7:30 in the Creation Room upstairs. We are going to send out an email blast too. So if you didn't sign up, make sure you write down your email. Maybe write it down again for us. It's short. And like Andy said, we'll be in the back. Also just something.
Yeah.
And for our first meetup, we've planned for everyone to bring a snack. And we're going to be introducing ourselves, just getting to know each other, and also talk about our plans for the group. We want to make sure that our group is group-led, so we want to talk about the things that we want to do. And we also ask, just when we're in our initial stages, we ask that our allies please hang back. We do love you so much, but we want to make sure that we create a safe space for our LGBTQ family, and we'll have opportunities for allies to join us later. And finally, please take a moment to fill out your green connection card in your bulletin. Whether you've been here forever or it's your first time, it matters to us that you're here today. And if you're new, we especially ask that you fill out a card with your email address so we can send you a note of greeting during the week. Please turn in the card with the offering collector. We also invite you to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Just as we come together in so many ways to support our wider community, we also join together to support the church. It takes all of us to keep FCC thriving. One important way to share your generosity is through a financial donation to the church. There are several ways that you can give. You can go to the FCC giving page on our website, use the QR code on the back of the bulletin, use the Vanco mobile app, or you can text your gift, or you can give in real time to the ushers who are coming around right now. Thank you for your generosity.
Thank you.
from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Six days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John, and led them high up onto the mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, my beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." The disciples freaked out. They fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. May God's wonder be revealed to us through the mystery of his word."
God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Gospel classic was made famous by Reverend F.C. Barnes and Reverend Janice Brown, and it sings of life as a journey, a hard journey, not a scenic walk through a garden or an all-inclusive river cruise, but a steep climb on the rough side of a mountain.
Amen.
Peter, James, and John leave their worlds behind the journey with Jesus. Together, they walk through suffering, tending the sick, feeding the hungry, serving the poor. Alongside him, through thick and thin, these three companions of Jesus are faithful, but also relatable. James and John enjoy receiving acknowledgement for their good deeds. They enjoy their newfound status as disciples. Peter is passionate and bold, and he also sinks into fear and doubt. Jesus reminds them again and again, "Fear not," a phrase that appears 365 times in the Bible. they walk together on this journey, they are thrown into one difficult situation after another. With each encounter, they confront their own personal obstacles, blocks within themselves that keep them from showing up fully in love. They continue to dig deep. In the middle of the Gospel of Matthew, they have hit their stride, their hearts are open, they flow with newfound energy like the Colorado River liberated from the Hoover Dam, full of Shakti, as it's called in Hinduism, what we call the Holy Spirit. With Jesus by their side, they meet each new challenge. Right before today's reading, this flow of energy comes to a screeching halt. Jesus tells them that he must go to Jerusalem, where he will be killed, and on the third day, raised. This does not compute. They are stunned in silence. Then Peter takes Jesus aside and says, God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you. They are scared, unable to imagine climbing life's journey alone. Then this morning's reading begins. Jesus tells them to climb the mountain, so they begin to climb. Imagine that steep, rocky incline, lungs working overtime, legs and feet aching as they continue to ascend, their backs cry out, they are drenched in sweat. Reaching the top, they gasp for breath. As they look out from this vantage point, they are startled by a new perspective of the land through which they've been toiling. Oxygen fills their lungs, their bodies begin to relax. They turn to Jesus and see his face shining like the sun. He's joined by Elijah and Moses. His clothes and his whole body are bathed in light. When the cloud passes over, they are silent in awe. They hear a voice say, this is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Peter, James, and John fall down to the ground in fear. Then Jesus says what he said so many times before. He reminds them, get up and do not be afraid. Early theologians like Gregory of Nyssa and Maximus the Confessor, what an awesome name, pondered the meaning of this mountaintop moment. They asked, was the transfiguration for Jesus alone? Or did this revelation reveal the latent potential within each one of us? Throughout Jesus' life, he taught, when we open our hearts, even in the midst of fear and darkness, each one of us can shine brighter than ever imagined. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, you are the light of the world. People do not light a lamp and put it under a bushel basket. Rather, they put it on a lampstand, and it gives light to all. In the same way, let your light shine before others. You are the light of the world. It is 2016, wedding season in the Rogers household. My sister Julie is marrying her wife to be Alyssa. We've been together for 4 years, and I have never seen my sister happy. Julie is a minister, and Alyssa works in theater, and wherever they go, they create community, and their wedding will be no different. But as preparations for the wedding get underway, there are obstacles. Members of the family declare that they cannot support the marriage of two brides. So in the midst of all the joy and excitement that surrounds everywhere, there is difficulty, uncomfortable conversations. Family members express fear and doubt. There is a deep sadness that some of the siblings' chairs will be empty. A steep climb on the rough side of the mountain, and there is also the flowing force of love.
many millennials, Julie and Alyssa decided to hold their ceremony outside with the reception at a tent. An hour before the ceremony, my cousin and my uncle tune their instruments next to the chuppah. My partner, Allison, scurries about fulfilling her responsibilities as the day of coordinator. And Julie and Alyssa watch from a window as the guests arrive, and they cheer on each child as they take the long walk across the field to where the ceremony will take place. As family and friends gather together, we put difficulties behind us and we rise above. And collectively, we are unaware that storm clouds are growing over us. The ceremony goes off without a hitch. Then we move into the tent where Julie and Alyssa gracefully connect with each one of us and receive each touch. My father, wearing his trademark Broadway baseball cap, declares, "Love is love is love is love is love." Then Julie and Alyssa lead the charge onto the dance floor. The love that Julie and Alyssa pour into others is being poured back into them abundantly. As joy fills the air, the winds begin to pick up. As more folks move onto the dance floor, the rain starts to pour. Concerned whispers begin to spread and become louder. They gasp of real fear as we realize that the whole tent may just blow away. Some guests grab centerpieces from the tables and use them to hold down the sides of the tent. The growing roar of rain pummels the tent and strong winds rock it side to side. Then suddenly, pounding rain flows. The wind ceases to blow. A collective sigh as the world becomes silent. Julie and Alyssa, the newlywed couple, run outside. To all of us, family and friends, follow them. As we come out of the tent, we see Julie and Alyssa standing just down the field, hand in hand, bathed in an extraordinary light. Above their heads, a double rainbow streams across the sky. There we stand, together, in silence and in awe, experiencing the love between these two brothers in a world illuminated and transformed by love, held in a double rainbow. Blessings fill the air. In many legends from around the world, the rainbow is seen as the bridge between heaven and earth. Julie and Alyssa turn around to face us, foam splashed pictures, the newlyweds beam brighter than ever. Julie and Alyssa bless us with their love. They light the way. Double rainbow, a sign of heavenly confirmation. We are ready to return to the world so that our love light shines in. As we walk down and begin the journey of Lent where we come face to face with inevitable fears and deaths, let us remember that each one of us is a unique expression of God's love. God delights in the diversity of her creation. We are different colors, illuminated by a common light. When we let our light shine, we too become rainbow. Our love becomes blessed. May it be so.
please join us in our closing commission. The Spirit of God is upon us.
God has anointed us to bear good news to the afflicted, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives, to open the prisons of those who are bound. Let us go forth in the name of Christ to bring peace into broken relationships, healing to alienated persons, and justice into oppressive structures. Amen.
Friends, we now stand on the threshold of Lent, a season where we say farewell to the joy of Epiphany and prepare ourselves for the challenging journey ahead. The path at times will be dark and difficult, calling us to deeper awareness of God's call and honesty about where we fall short. We began the season of Epiphany by following the light of the star which led the Magi to Bethlehem. During the season, we have been celebrating the light of Jesus, rejoicing in the revelations of God. Part of the expression of this joy has been our saying and singing the word Alleluia. But now, that will end. As we begin our more somber season of life, we will no longer say or sing the word Alleluia in worship. Its absence will remind us of the darkness we must face during this time. This year, Eli will be our keeper of the Alleluia, helping to lead us in this ritual today and bringing it back for us in the glory on Easter morning.